Okay, thank you for watching my college writing tips. This one, I think I called it for all the love for the love of all that's holy. Please use spell check. The actual title of this, of the essay that I wrote on my blog, constantgeography.com, is actually called "Respect Yourself and Spell Check Yourself." It is amazing how many people just throw essentially garbage at me. I mean, I'm not gonna dance around and try to be nice about it, because there are a number of students that will literally just write anything down and then they'll send it to me in an email or on Canvas or Blackboard. And wow, what a waste of time, and what a waste of their time. And because the reality is, as I'm trying to communicate on these videos, is that I'm here to coach you on how to be successful, on how to add a little bit of success to your life. And one of my pet peeves, and in fact every faculty member is becoming sort of really irritated about this, is don't communicate to us in writing or in email messages in the form of a text message. You know, that is horrible. You know, we're professionals, we get paid for our job, you know, we try, at least I try to, is we communicate to you on a hopefully a professional in a professional way, and so you need to communicate back to us in a professional way. Yeah, there's a lot of disrespect going on, not just in academia, but in the world in general. And if you want to, so it's really easy to say, well, they disrespected me, I'm going to disrespect them. Okay, well, then that just boils over into everything, and then we actually go downhill as a society rather than say, you know what, I'm not going to act this way. I'm going to take the high road and respond back in a professional manner. That's what society will expect. You know, if you're, when you are dealing, you know, if you go to work with for Microsoft or Intel or Apple or whatever, you're going to have to rise up to a level of decorum that you may not be used to. And if you want people to respect you, you have to be the one that initiates the respect. Right? You can always step down to somebody else's level, but then you've gone down to their level, and you don't really want to do that. You want to either bring them up to your level, or find somebody else at a, you know, at an emotional, logical, rational level that you can work with. And so spell check really tells me, when I get writing from students that have gone through and done a reasonably good job in working on grammar and punctuation and spell checking their stuff, that tells me you care about how you present yourself. If you don't spell check, if you don't care about grammar, if you don't care about punctuation, it essentially tells me you don't care about what you're doing. And I can't really believe that. I believe that if people are going to spend the time to do something, I really believe that they sort of care about it, at least a little bit. And the thing is like, it doesn't take, you know, maybe 5 or 10 minutes to go through and spell check a document and then correct the things that are initially, you know, they find to be in errors. Correct the errors that they find. And so that basically also communicates, well, this person isn't going to even take 5 minutes to fix, you know, the I before E rules, and they're not going to look for things like there, you know, that conflict, T-H-E-I-R versus T-H-E-R-E, you know. There's all sorts of things that crop into people's writing. They write to me like I'm their grandmother, or they write an email to me or an essay like I'm, you know, just somebody off the street. And that's not the way you want to present yourself to people that are professionals. You take on the persona of someone who's professional, and you're providing another professional information or documentation. That's what the habits you need to get into. That's what society will expect. That's what the business world will expect. So again, this is all about coaching you so that you can be successful or add a little bit more success to what you're doing in your academic life, and hopefully that will spill over into your life beyond academia. Nothing can kill a good bit of writing like poor grammar, the lack of or the misuse of punctuation, and of course spelling. Journal writing activities, which seem to, you know, students hate to write journals. And I used to give journal assignments in my geography classes, and honestly, they hated them for about the first 5 or 6 of them. And you're probably saying, oh my God, 5 or 6 journal entries? usually what I would have them do is write 10 to 15. But the purpose of them is twofold. One is to expose you to information that you wouldn't normally get inside a class. And the other one is essentially to coach people on how to write well, on how to analyze and look for information. From what I gather, journal writing in middle and high school are essentially usually a component of the academic portfolios and are required, but they're really trying to coach you on how to write well. However, those journals, as I've come to find out, are kind of pointless in the fact that they just let you do free writing. And free writing is not really it's okay for doing at home, but you don't free write in college and you don't free write in the university level. And if you don't go through and spell check and check your grammar and punctuation, you're gonna fail. Simply put, you're gonna get zeros, and that's not gonna help you out. So, and, you know, maybe you are in high school and you're watching these videos and they're allowing you to do free writing and they don't care. They say just write. You don't care about spelling. Don't care about punctuation. Don't care about mixing your tenses. I would say ignore those and do try to spend some time paying attention to that stuff. Writers, I follow a lot of writers on social media, and writers will essentially, they may ignore grammar and punctuation and spelling and stuff on their first draft, but then they'll go through and fix that on a second draft and continue to refine it on different drafts. Well, you don't want to treat a writing assignment as a draft. It's not a draft. You should write a draft, and maybe you do those things like a journal writing where you just write down things, stream of consciousness type exercise, and then you go through and write a second draft and you fix issues, you fix grammar, and then you write a third draft and you fix more things, and then you turn in, something that's been revised 3 or 4 times. What I'm getting usually is what I call a draft, and drafts get zeros in my classes because I need for you to go through and fix punctuation, fix spelling, fix grammar, change your word order, make sure your thoughts flow in a rational, logical order. Don't give me stuff that uses a lot of contractions. Use examples. Basically what I end up getting as a person's final assignment or a final, basically their final homework assignment, or their what they would call their submission is essentially a draft. And so you can't do that. You've got to go through, particularly like if you've got time to work on something, is you have to go through and constantly refine it. If you don't refine it, you're probably going to get a C, a D, you maybe get a failing grade. So longer writing assignments like research papers, you're going to have to do that on. In my classes, I expect you to perhaps maybe have written a draft on your own. But if you turn in a draft to me, usually drafts get anywhere from a C to a D to a failing grade. And they're pretty easy to pick out, actually. The other thing to think about, too, is you're not writing just for this class. You're also trying to pick up good traits because this is a global society that we work in. I teach world geography. Some of you probably have seen some of my geography videos or my weather videos. Now, the problem with thinking that you're only doing this for a class is that you think you're only going to do this for this class and then you're not going to have to use it anymore. That's a bad way of thinking because the rest of the world is going to expect a level of a high level of achievement from you. You may one time find yourself working with people from France or Germany or Korea or Japan, and they're going to already have a level of achievement well beyond yours if you're not careful. Nowhere in the world is writing allowed which permits students to write junk, to my knowledge. Nowhere in the world will you find books, articles, websites, or any other professional media written without adherence to formal writing rules. Again, notice I said professional media. Now, that is changing. I wrote this essay in 2013, it's 2014, and honestly, there's even journalism has just really gone downhill, and even good website, well, what I would have called good websites, like, CNN, some of the other news websites, even those are falling apart simply because of poor writing, poor journalism, poor research, and they're no longer really good for, I mean, not people would argue with me and say they've never been good, but even within the last 5 years, and I have a feeling it's because the college writing skills have just are deplorable, and nobody knows really how to write well, and it's getting worse, it's not getting better. Now I will say this, so I said nowhere in the world will you find writing which permits students to write junk, to my knowledge, except in the United States, except here. Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Saudi, German, French, you name the culture, students of English in all of those cultures are learning formal writing rules and expected to use them at all times. I've had students, the reason I pull those cultures out is because I've dealt with students from those cultures, and they are expected to learn those rules, and some of them learn the rules better than most American students. I know we've been exposed to them, but you know, we tend to take it for granted and we throw it away. We throw the knowledge away. Well, they're not throwing the knowledge away. And what's going to end up happening is they're going to know our business culture better than we know our business culture if we're not careful. And I say if we're not careful like it's a danger or a threat, but the reality is we don't want to expose ourselves, expose unnecessary vulnerabilities within our economy, within our culture, within our society, because of our intransigence, because of our willingness and willful grasp of our own ignorance. That's just ridiculous. So, and that's another part of these videos is it's sort of my own personal remedy to kind of counter some of the things that I see within the educational system that really is going to damage us in the long run. There are some good things happening, but in terms of writing and writing skills and critical thinking, there's some really bad things happening. And writing is one of the best ways to go through and encourage critical thinking. Too many high school students believe their college writing is fine because they were allowed to get away with writing abysmal stuff in high school. Poor writing leads to poor thinking. Poor thinking leads to poor communication. Poor communication leads to bad interpretation of ideas and concepts, and you don't get your point across, or it could actually lead to, you know, loss of friendships, loss of job, loss of relationships. It could mean a business deal goes sour. It could mean relations between countries go bad. You know, there could be all sorts of bad consequences from this. Nothing good comes from allowing students to write whatever they want without critical input. So yeah, I've told some people that your work is really crappy. You can't write like this. You know, I don't like telling somebody that, but honestly, in good faith, I can't let this person think that what they've written is decent and should be put out there for public consumption, because it doesn't make sense. It's not logically consistent. They haven't outlined an argument. They don't have a thesis statement. They don't have supporting evidence. You know, they just haven't done a very good job of outlining this. So it's my job as an educator, and I really call myself as a coach, to say, I can't let you do this. You know, I don't want you to hurt yourself mentally. Just like a football coach would, or a baseball coach would say, I can't let you do this. I can't let you play. I can't let you pitch. I can't let you kick. I can't let you do whatever, because you're going to hurt yourself. And that's what educators are trying to communicate. You know, some people will say, well, you need to be worried about their egos. You can't be mean. You can't tell them these kinds of things. Well, the problem is that somebody has to. Somebody has to say, you can't write like this. Somebody has to step up and say, you know, this grammar is not good. You can't, these ideas are nonsensical. Your research is from sources that aren't credible. You know, so there's a whole host of things that go into good writing. And so that's where the college professors have been through this. They've, for the most part, I've run across some that seem to have different opinions. But for the most part, we've all been through this kind of coaching ourselves to learn how to think critically and how to separate things out. Now, I am speaking in broad terms here, but we, most if not all of us, have been through this. And so when somebody tells you can't write like that, usually they're coming from a pretty good place. Wait until they reach college or university and fail their first semester. You know, I don't want you to fail your first semester. I don't want you to fail your second semester. I want you to be successful, but I want you to improve as your academic career goes on. So in my 100 level classes, I might tell somebody right out of high school, you can't write like this. You can write in high school like this because that was acceptable. It is not acceptable here. And so I'm trying to help you, and it may take, you know, somebody may get their ego crushed a little bit because they've been coddled through their high school and told they're excellent writers. Well, the reality is those adults are not doing anybody any favors. And I'm sorry if they've been through that process, but you know, it's time to change that, because unless you go to master's or work on a PhD, there's not going to be school for a while after you graduate with your undergraduate degree. Now you're going to be out there in the world, and you're going to be competing against not only people, you know, in Kentucky or wherever, but you're going to be competing against other people in the United States, you know, maybe Canada, and maybe globally. And so you need to put your best foot forward. That's why college is a safe environment to do that. I personally blame a lot of my peers, and my peers are the ones that I was in high school with. And honestly, my thought process goes something like this. My peers, people my age, people I was in high school with, are the ones changing policies today. And in my mind, and this is just my opinion, is that they're trying to make up for the bad feelings that they got when they were in high school. They're attempting to build a kinder, gentler, and altogether reckless educational system based on their own personal hatred or anathema of their own high school experience. My memories of high school involve listening to the whines of homework, complaints about the relevance of some subjects, and the foreshadowing of today's conditions. When I have kids, I'll make sure they never go through this. Okay, well, you survived, and you're better for it. And yeah, you need to get over the emotional baggage of, you know, this person hurt my feelings. Okay, so maybe they did hurt your feelings. Feelings are ephemeral. You know, they're transitory, they don't last very long. And really what they were saying is, they were trying to say, do this, you're capable of doing better, you should do better, you should fix this and make it better. But instead, all the person chose to hear was, your paper sucks. You know, and that's too bad, because their paper probably did suck. You know, so we have to step back from the emotional part of things and look to see what's really going on and what the real intent of this message is. You know, they're not telling you suck as a person. They're saying, fix this. This is not good. You are capable of doing better. And that's why I'm making these videos, is because I think everybody is capable of doing better if they just apply themselves. And most of these things in these videos that I'm talking about, you know, maybe they might add on, you know, 15 or 20 minutes to a writing assignment or something like that. But once you have the habit down, then you won't even have to think about it anymore. The only people who do not believe writing is fundamental to society are feckless individuals who seek to control people through fear and the manipulation of facts. Because if you don't learn to write, and if you don't learn to think, and if you don't learn to critically think, then you're going to be vulnerable to media outlets and other sources of information that are going to want to push things at you, and you're going to anticipate that those things are correct, and they're not going to be correct. Not anticipate, but you're going to maybe assume or believe that those details are correct, and they're not going to. Writing lies at the heart of reason, of logic, of thought, of critical thinking, to the pursuit of knowledge. It's vital to the continuation of a free and open society. If we damage writing, if we damage the skill and the techniques of writing, society becomes inflicted with potentially a fatal disease. We have to write. Rather than become complicit in you know, damaging our society, what I would recommend is you work against the damaging effects of bad writing in our society, and pay attention to your own thoughts and how those thoughts manifest themselves into words. Learn to use spell check technology in Word, any other editing program that you have. There's an app I use once in a while called Ginger that checks your writing on web pages. So there's lots of technology that's available. There's Canvas, the learning management system Canvas, the learning management system Blackboard. They all have built-in spell check tools. And essentially, if you don't use those, you're basically saying either I'm not spending enough time with this, I'm I'm too lazy, I'm too ignorant, or something like that, because there's not really any excuse not to use some of the grammar checking and spell checking technologies that have infused our all of our technology. So if you can write well, though, and writing well is sort of a subversive action in society, because if you can write well, you can convince people that can't write well. Not that I'm a subversive personality, but if you spend any time at all on the internet, there's lots of great websites, Boing Boing and Reddit and Brain Picker, that have some excellent essays of people who obviously are well educated, or at least pay attention to the way they write. So pay attention to the way you write. It'll improve your grades, and it'll probably improve the way that you think overall, and will help mature your thinking process beyond your academic career. Thank you for watching.